You're listening to the Soulless Minions of Orthodoxy, alternative DVD commentaries. Hello, my name is Josh, and with me in the Soulless Minions studios, as always, is my brother Justin. Say hello, please.
Hello, please.
Our movie for today is Santa Claus the Movie from, I believe, 1985.
Do you?
I believe so. And it's directed by Gino Schwartz. We still haven't
We've had that debate before.
Haven't figured it out quite what it is, but you know what we mean. Starring the best Santa Claus ever.
Save that for later.
Okay. Our sync point for today is right after the title card Alexander Salkind Presents Fades to Black. On the DVD, that's about 7 seconds. It may vary on the Blu-ray, but just get to that point and we'll all be set. So just go ahead and unpause when you hear me say unpause and we'll watch the movie together. Here comes the countdown. 3, 2, 1, unpause. All right, so some stars twinkling and Santa Claus.
The little light bulbs are not twinkling.
I know, Arden. Thanks for noticing.
And right now, aren't we opening up on a really cheesy song?
I think
every Christmas Eve, we are part of a miracle.
Is it that one? Yeah, I thought it was Score for a second, but yeah, I think you're right. Oh, there are some other cheesy songs in this movie.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Well.
All right. Well,
it's Christmas time. It's the season. So we've been wanting to do this for a while. So we figured, why not now? Good as time as any. And we do love this movie.
We do, despite
its
probably
flaws. Which we're
going to
point out as the commentary progresses.
Well, you know, the beginning here kind of moves along briskly, I want to say. So I want to address a couple things. I put the movie on, was letting it play for a little bit before we started, and was just kind of thinking to myself that somehow, and given the people behind this movie, it rather defies all odds that it actually achieved something. But at the very least, the first, 30, 45 minutes of the movie have somehow tapped into, at least for you and me, and, you know, our whole family, and well, I guess those are the only people I know that have seen it, but this movie somehow tapped into almost like our unconsciousness of what we all thought Santa Claus was. And when it comes to his origin here, the specifics about the Vendicomps, which he's talking, I don't really care about that crap.
It's the Vendicomp.
But everything beyond that terminology, him going out into the snow, whatever actually happens to him out there, we'll talk about, I guess. But connecting to the elves, being granted immortality, all of that, not so much in its specifics, but its feel felt like it just stepped out of our collective consciousness. And I thought that was really interesting how they pulled that off. They're about to show him come to this little, I don't know, what is this, an orphanage? Whatever it is.
Tiny little hamlet.
Yeah, whatever it is. He has Donner and Blitzen as his original.
Is it Donner and
reindeer.
Blitzen? Those are the two?
Yeah, it's okay. Donner and Blitzen. I never thought about that. I thought that was a really nice touch. And, maybe it's just because that there are so many universal elements to the origin of Santa Claus that it feels this way. But I think they pretty much nailed it.
Mm-hmm.
And made it feel like this is what it always was, mm-hmm. whether it was or was not.
Well, at least for the first third of the movie.
Yeah, exactly. You know, after that, it turns into something different.
Yeah, it does.
And we'll address that, too, I suppose, when it comes up. But
and I'll say it before. I've said it before, and I'll say it again. This movie just looks Europe-y to me. just like Supergirl.
It was shot on the other side.
I know. But it has that feeling, you know, particularly in this scene.
It does.
This movie was produced by those two guys.
The Salkinds. Yeah, I did mention them, so I suppose we should address it, that this was made by the Salkinds, who are famously / notoriously connected to the original Superman movies for producing those. and was directed by Jeannot Schwartz, who we mentioned, who, along with the Salkinds, made Supergirl. So, I mean, that's the connection between all these guys. Hence, there's almost no good godly reason why this movie should have worked at all. But like I said, they got a lot of things right. And the things that work so well that you're willing to forgive the things that don't. But, you know, here we are. And I like that they did this, by the way. And I never really thought about it until just now. They don't call out what year this is.
Nope.
You just clearly know that it's a long time ago.
In the past.
And also, we don't know too much about Claus here.
They start off with the... They don't start off, he's already Santa Claus, as with so many other movies. I mean, he's just a regular guy. He's a do-gooder. He likes to give gifts around his small town. He's a lover of children and toy making. You know?
Yeah.
A skilled master of toys, something in that regard. And that's great. Most movies don't do that. I mean, it's really about the Santa Claus mythos, the legend.
Right.
And, you know, not a lot of movies will touch that. They'll make silly comedies like Santa Claus with Tim Allen, you know.
Yeah, no, this is definitely an attempt to show us the classic, you know, figure of Santa Claus and how he came to be.
Mm-hmm.
I actually think it's kind of interesting that they didn't try and take him back even earlier to maybe show his birth and what led him to be this kind of guy. I don't miss it, but I'm kind of surprised that they didn't, given that they even went this far back to show how he came in contact with the elves. And he, you know, we'll see these things throughout the movie, the suit, the songs, everything. You know, they kind of touch on some of the major points, which is really neat. Which, again, I can't... Can you? I cannot think of another Santa Claus movie that is essentially an origin story.
Well, I can think of one. You've seen it.
Other than that one.
Yeah, wasn't it made in the Netherlands
Dutch
or something like that?
Yeah, something. But that was fairly recent.
Yeah, that's true. It was.
Other than that, I can't think of anything that dealt with it.
Not off the top of my head either. No.
Exactly. I'm kind of mystified as to why they haven't done that. You know, Santa Claus is an ancient, ancient figure.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how many movies have we seen about Jesus? How many movies about Superman?
Did you have a hypothesis about this scene?
As far as what is about to happen?
Yeah, because you mentioned that earlier. I'm trying to figure out what you meant by that.
Do you think they die?
Yeah, I thought that's where you were going.
Yeah.
You know, that the whole movie...
Or do you think the elves showed up like before they die?
That the whole movie is a delusion?
No. More that...
Oh, okay. Well, yeah, I've heard that...
Their mortal, you know, bodies died, and the elves came and resurrected them in a new form.
I never thought about it that way. Never as a kid, not now.
Because to me, how are they not dead?
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Possibly. I guess you could see it that way. I never thought about it.
You know, either that or, like we're about to see here, maybe the elves came and shined the light and brought the warmth just in time to save them. I don't know. I think you could kind of go either way with it.
Either way, it's not explained and it doesn't have to be. But
I actually prefer to think that they died.
They died. Yeah, that they transcended their mortal bodies.
Exactly. I think there's something kind of magical about that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because the way they pull back in that the previous shot, it looks like, okay, it's lights out.
You know, I think the Salkinds need to do another legend story.
Another epic.
They definitely had a pedigree for it. I mean, successful or not, they seem to enjoy doing it. And I enjoy Superman, and I enjoy this. I haven't seen the Three Musketeers or the Four Musketeers, but...
I've seen pieces.
They have a way about doing these kind of movies that I obviously like, even though this movie is very corny in a lot of respects. It's very enjoyable at the same time.
Now, they're obviously in the north, so I wonder what north village or whatever area that they actually lived in.
Well, maybe they were transported there. I'm not sure.
No, I don't think so.
Because they seem to be far more north than where they just were.
I agree, but That's the Salkinds for you.
Mm-hmm.
That's where they mess up on little details like that.
Yeah.
That you end up questioning. Now, here we are. Here are the elves.
Mm-hmm.
I think they both work and they don't.
How do you mean?
I think they definitely achieved, without overt cheesiness, I don't want to say naivete, but their separation from the rest of the world. They don't in any way feel modern, which is great.
Kind of a timeless innocence.
Yeah, that good way to put it. Their costumes are, I think, where it starts to fail a little. It's a little too
tacky,
perhaps. I mean, I see what they were going for.
Kind of formed, you know, kind of like figurines almost.
Yeah, yeah, almost like, you know, action figures. You know, where they're set up just for that. It's not that they're bad per se. That they're just
they
obvious.
Look like costumes. You know, they don't look like clothes.
That, you nailed it. They look like costumes. Mm-hmm. They don't.
See, like what they're what they're wearing. Yeah,
that's real.
Yeah, that's yeah.
Yeah, that's a good way. They look like costumes. Not bad, just like costumes, that's all.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but those three guys in the background, they have a quirky, you know, innocence to them, and I like that.
You had a good way of putting it in the Bill and Ted, Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey commentary about how they were dressed as compared to the first movie. In the first movie, it looked natural. Their clothes looked lived in, you know, as opposed to the second one where they seemed more like costumes, more staged, more set up, like they were action figures almost.
Right, right.
Like proposed to be action figures, and that was a good way of putting it. Kind of the same way with this.
Yeah, I think so. Again, not bad in either of those examples. Mm-hmm. Just obvious.
I guess I'm glad they didn't go with little people, that they just chose to do short.
Just shorter
short,
guys.
Short guys.
Yeah.
You know.
Also, some not just their costuming, but some of the props and everything. Again, it has that manufactured, you know, quality to it.
Yeah. This was a nice...
Again, not bad. I mean, if I owned any of them, they'd be really neat to look at. But
this was a nice touch. You know, the house, the Santa Claus residence cannot be seen unless they want it to be seen.
But it's always there. That's huge, too. It's gorgeous looking,
oh,
really.
Oh, I'd love to have this. I mean, it looks like...
That's really neat.
It looks like a snow globe, you know, a house in a snow globe almost.
Yeah, it kind of does, actually. Now, what do you think about Dudley Moore here?
I love him in this movie. I love Miss Patch.
Mm-hmm.
He's great.
As much as I enjoy Miss Patch, despite what I just said about all of the elves not feeling modern, he does. He feels modern.
Yes, he does.
Maybe it's because he's the only one I recognize.
He has, because he brings baggage to the movie.
Maybe that's all it is. I don't think it's his performance.
No. No.
But look at the inside of this place. They nailed it. They really did.
Well, I think there's some parts of it that work, some parts that don't. The coloring is a little too... I like the wood. You know, it has a very...
Yeah, well, it's those props.
Yeah,
it's those...
yeah, it has a very old-fashioned look to it, which is nice. But see, they have some this coloring, like this yellow and red lamp and the banister over there. It's just, it's like they got it great, and then they went in and they painted some of it, and they ruined it.
Yeah, that's, that's a really good way to phrase it. Yeah, I think
but
you're right.
Other than that, I mean, this looks like where the Keebler elves make their cookies or whatever.
Yeah, it does. It does. It's mixed in with stone. That's really nice.
Yeah, that's some nice... you know,
it would have been nice if the wood looked a little older.
Yeah, a little more aged. Yeah,
a little
more
used.
Yeah, it does.
But it still looked great.
Yeah.
Welcome. I'm the one called Puffy.
I'm called Puffy. I don't know Puffy. Man wants to see. He's the one who loses out to Patch and doesn't get the red apron.
Which was tricky because, you know, for a section of the movie here, Puffy is technically the antagonist. But he's not a bad guy. He's just...
Well, Puffy? No.
No, he just wants to be the lead elf also. But there's nothing wrong with Puffy. He's just not Patch, that's all. And I like that. That's something they could have screwed up. You know, they could have made him, like, almost villainous. But no, you can't do that. He's a friggin' elf.
Yeah, no, you can't.
So, you know, this stuff, you know. I have a plan to heat this place using pipes.
Using pipes, you know, cylinder thingies.
Yeah, see, I think that was an ill-placed joke. You know, it brought it too modern again. And it's just because it's coming out of Dudley Moore, you know, it's like, well, you know, you're the modern, you know, sore.
This was a nice...
Nice touch.
Nice touch. It's endless. It seems to go on forever, I suppose.
Well, they've been doing this for a while.
Mm-hmm. Well, they've been preparing for his arrival. That's what what they said. So they've had to create all these toys.
Mm-hmm. They don't really go into that too much, do they? As far as how long and waiting for him. Why were they waiting for him? Why was no one else good enough? They don't really touch into that specifically that I recall.
Yeah.
Do you?
If they were, how long they've been waiting for him? Is that what you're
saying? Just any of those specifics. They just said that we've been waiting.
Just basically that. It's all more or less implied. It's that Salkind thing again. You know, they don't really explain. And I don't think it's particularly necessary.
No, again, I don't miss it. It just would have been interesting to see where they went with it.
Mm-hmm.
I love that how he knelt down and caressed the
horse.
The horse. It was just, he's like, wow, you know, you guys, I do this stuff too.
Yeah, this is great. Yeah.
This is beautiful. Nice touch.
See, you know, that makes me wonder if maybe they should have kept this in this time frame. Don't go to the present, to the modern times. This look doesn't clashes with what becomes the rest of this after the first third is over, what consumes the movie, you know,
the second and third acts.
It's the 80s, you know, New York setting in BZ, and it clashes with this classic look. If they kept it in a more, I mean, they didn't have to stay in this exact time, but in the olden times,
yeah,
it maybe would have worked all the way through.
I get what you're saying. I remember the extras on the old DVD for this.
Yeah.
And they talk about,
I want to have a cubby like this to sleep in.
Oh my God, right? that they talk about the conflict in the movie and that everyone involved really enjoyed the first act, but then they realized, you know, the whole movie can't be sugar and saccharine. It has to have conflict.
Yeah, I remember that.
And they very wisely, of course, you don't want to make any of the elves bad or anything. So their solution was to bring him into modern day times and have him, you know, go up against a toy maker. I mean, on paper it works, but like you said, the two worlds kind of clash. It would have been interesting to see if they maybe worked the problem a little more and somehow gave him a conflict in the older times like this and kept it a strict origin story.
Well, it,
you know,
could have been.
Whereas by the time it gets to modern day time, it's like, well, that's our Santa. You know?
It didn't necessarily have to have a conflict in the traditional sense. It could have been a moral conflict within Santa himself. He didn't have to be a person or a thing,
you know,
necessarily.
No, you're right. You're right. I mean, when I think about an example of a movie where there is no villain, I always go back to Star Trek IV and how that movie has no villain.
The conflict, you know,
time was a conflict. Yeah. The situation was a conflict, but no villain. And yet the movie is fantastically exciting and fun. So just goes to show you don't have to have a, you know, mustache twirling villain.
Exactly. So they,
you know,
they might have been able to.
Oh, I'm sure they could have. It would have completely changed the. You know, last two thirds of the movie would have been a different movie, but it would have been interesting. This white-faced boy here, that's old. But of course, maybe or maybe we would not still have John Lithgow. And how do you not have John Lithgow?
Yeah.
I mean,
but he's almost, it's like he's almost from another movie, you know?
It is.
That's what it feels like.
It is, unfortunately. And that's not the actor's fault. You know, it's
no. He was hamming it up as he was told to,
and he did it beautifully. It just was in conflict with this part of the movie.
Mm-hmm. A clock that wakes you up. Patch alarm clock.
That's not bad.
That's not bad.
If they had made this movie today, they probably would have used, you know, regular size actors like these guys were, but digitally shrunk them like Lord of the Rings style.
Oh, yeah, that would have been.
To be smaller, but not little people.
If I would have liked that, no.
I'm just saying that's probably what they would have done.
Oh, nowadays?
Yeah.
Yeah, probably, but that would be.
Just to give it that surreal factor.
Nah.
Works in Lord of the Rings.
I guess. I don't like too much manipulation. I mean, I know it. I mean, I know those actors aren't that short, so it's, yeah. it doesn't sit right with me.
Wow. This is kind of nice.
They all
see,
wake
look,
up
that old, that wood and everything on the floor looks a little more used.
Yeah.
It's nice.
So it looks like they have different shifts and they share beds, right?
Yeah.
Because they flipped the name.
Yeah.
That was
yeah.
an interesting
But yet
touch.
The place was quiet before, so
yeah,
kind of messed that up.
Yeah, it's like the graveyard shift's over, morning shift is starting. Let's
yeah,
go.
It's a nice touch that it's 24 hours, only they screwed it up and didn't show it as being 24 hours.
Yeah, right.
That's the Salkinds for you.
They all look so jolly. It's just I can't imagine them being so happy all the time. But okay, I guess that's
this scene. Of course, makes me think of Elf.
Which scene?
The beginning scene when you see the elves building the toys.
Oh, you're not a cotton-headed ninny muggins.
You know, they just love what they do.
Oh, they just can't. Green just isn't his color. Maybe it's the massive bulk of it. See, this was nice. I mean, it's very superficial, but it's nice to see them actually develop the suit. In like,
it is.
The red wasn't always the first choice. You know, it's like they might have gone with green, or they said brown. He's like, red. Oh, yeah, perfect.
Yeah, no, it was. It was. You could all argue that it's a throwaway scene, but it works. You know, it's again, it's one of those things that when you see it, you're like, yeah, that totally works. That's how it should have been, you know. You know, I never actually really consciously realized it until now, but there are no female elves.
No, you're right. Maybe I haven't consciously perceived that myself. But
I
there
wonder
isn't.
Why that is. I mean, how do they reproduce? Maybe they're just determined. That's another thing that they gloss over. And perhaps that's a good thing, because too much information causes too many questions. But clearly these elves have been around for a long time. And obviously they are gifted with the same immortality that Santa Claus is later gifted with. They obviously just don't age. They don't explain why. You know, at least we get the scene where Santa Claus himself is bestowed.
Then that doesn't this always bother you?
What's that?
When he just threw the glitter on there?
Oh.
He's like, don't you think the guy doing the wheel would be like, hey, I got to start all over now. What are you doing? It looked fine.
I wanted green.
And that's
just
what
green.
I wanted. Jeez. Get your fairy dust off of this thing. I remember them telling us in the commentary that this took a little while to get in sync.
Yeah, to get everyone moving, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And for the they do use all reindeer. They don't have any animatronics, do they?
Oh, no, they do.
Oh, they do. Okay.
Like, for example, the scene where they maybe or maybe not die when the reindeer wake up. Those are animatronic.
Okay, good. Well, good.
But they
they're
did
good.
A very good
yeah,
job.
Yeah, they're good animatronics. Yeah,
thank God this is from the days of real effects.
Mm-hmm. But most of the time they do use the real reindeer.
So. Yes, for the most part, they went out and found. You know, I've never seen reindeer that look like that. They're amazing looking.
This is a nice scene. Season's greetings.
Yeah,
I like this. North by Northwest.
Now.
Yeah. Good stuff.
That's a pretty badass looking telescope.
All wood, too.
All wood. I love the sound of wood, you know, everything moving.
Yeah, the creaking of it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
See, look, he does look a little too dolled up. Like, he's got the blush on, you know, his cheeks and stuff.
Yeah, they go a little too far with that stuff.
The music in this scene is good.
The score for the movie is really quite good.
It is a good score, yeah. But you got to imagine they do this every year. Or is this the first time they've done it?
They don't say. See, this is some of those things that they gloss over.
They just say season's greetings. They don't mention if they've done this before. But, I mean, I can imagine that maybe this would be the first time. At least that they've ever experienced it like this. Because this is the first year they've had Santa with them.
Yeah, it's hard to say, man. It's really hard to say. It would have been nice, maybe, if they touched on something. Those are the kinds of things that could have been fleshed out had they kept it just in this time.
This is another thing that must have been difficult to dance around. I feel bad for the guy in the center of that because he's just turning in circles. Anyway.
Yeah.
See, they're just turning around. What's going on? You think they play up the jolliness a little too much?
Maybe a tad, but it doesn't go on too long.
And this, dare I say, is the best scene in the movie.
The takeoff?
Well, the preface. The build up. The preface of I forgot his name. The head elf.
Burgess
Meredith coming in with the long beard and anointing him Santa Claus, and it's a great scene. And then, of course, the takeoff. It's a really beautiful scene.
It really is. And again, it's the movie teeters where you're like, wow, I really wish they explained that, to the other side of the coin where
they don't
explain it, and mm-hmm. that's a good thing. You know,
yes.
I don't want to know any more than we are told about
you could assume he's an elder elf. For a while I assumed he was God.
Yeah, as a kid,
I thought he was God, because he has a long beard and
he's just like the ancient first elf. Mm-hmm. You know, again, that's all supposition because they don't actually say it.
Look at this guy, isn't he amazing? Why did he should just be Santa Claus all the time?
In everything.
He's just amazing.
They should remake every Santa Claus movie ever made and have him in it.
Say what you will about, you know, Miracle on 34th Street or whatever. He's awesome. He looks perfect.
How do you remake Miracle and not cast him?
I know. What was that?
How do you do that?
Jeez, it's a crime. It's a crime, sir. It's a travesty. This is good music, too. It's very slow and drawn out and mystical.
Who did the score for this? Was it David Newman?
I don't know. Let me see.
I don't know if I'm right, but my instinct says it was David Newman. And his stuff, for some reason, is notoriously difficult to get a hold of. I would love to have the score for this movie.
I'm surprised you don't. You have the score
for
everything.
No, it's... I don't think it was ever officially released.
So do you ever think he wonders, like, all right, this year, I'm cutting the beard. Seriously.
They should have had that scene.
Reindeer's bowing was a bit much, but...
Yeah.
What do they know?
I love the business of all the elves having to hold his
beard.
Long, long beard. Nice little touch.
It's a nice way of showing age without... explicitly saying his age.
Yeah, very, yeah. It works.
Yeah.
Again, it's a miracle that they did this stuff, given the people involved.
Mm-hmm.
There we go. No, 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 we don't need to see it. Just put some makeup on.
Who wrote this one? Who wrote this movie?
I don't know. Do you have the box in front of you?
It's David Newman.
Who did the score?
No, he wrote the screenplay.
Oh, that's why the name
David.
David
and Leslie Newman were a part.
Oh, the Newmans.
Yes.
Okay.
They were involved with Superman.
Yeah, they had taken a pass at the first, Superman 1 and 2 were written together. And Tom Mankiewicz came in and completely changed it. But then they did 3 all by themselves, and look how that turned out.
Well, you
can that's
totally
what I'm
see the difference.
Someone else must have had a hand in this, because this stuff does not seem to be Newman style.
No, it doesn't.
It's too subtle. It's too quiet.
At least maybe the first half was, the first third was written by somebody else, and then the rest of it is more Newman-esque.
It is. That's when you get to BZ and all that. That's when
that stuff is not
Newman.
Subtle at all.
Yeah.
No. The light of the world is a passage
of endless night. Of endless night
for you. I like, he has a little shake to him.
You know? Well, that's just Burgess Meredith.
I know, but that's something he did. Well, he was great. You know, sad to see him. Sad to see him go, but he did this well.
No. Yeah.
I wonder if Burgess Meredith didn't have any history with the Salkinds, did he? He was just hired for this.
Not that I know of.
Yeah. Oh, and neither did David Huddleston, now that I think about it. But
Yeah. No, they were just lucky casting choices.
Well, they don't explain the name either. I guess that's fine.
What's that?
Santa Claus.
Well, in his name is Claus. They don't explain the Santa part.
His name is not Kris Kringle?
No. In the very beginning, she's calling out to him when they're in the snow. She goes, Claus, I can't see you.
Sure, it's not Kris?
Nope, it's Claus.
Okay.
That was probably not a good choice. They should have made him be Kris Kringle, but whatever. But they don't call him Santa, obviously. In fact, he's just called Santa right here. You know, from now on, you will be called Santa Claus. You know, so, like, you know, Uncle Claus or whatever. here we go, man. This is
awesomeness.
God, they got it. You know, don't change a friend.
This song, this scene gives me chills. That's how good it is.
Yes, it does.
I mean, save and this.
It doesn't last long.
Save this moment here. But
yeah, this. I've seen TV versions of this, and they
cut this part out. Which is,
it works surprisingly well without it.
It takes you out of it.
Ethereal thing to then the epicness of his takeoff with this
kind
stuff.
It just in the middle. Yeah, it's kind of shoehorned
in. It breaks the mood.
It does. It kind of kills it for a minute, and then it brings it back, and it's...
And then it looks like these poor reindeer are
in pain. Yeah, I know.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
What the hell's wrong with me?
What did you give me that for? What was in that soup?
Jesus Christ, I can't see.
Okay, we're back. Thankfully, it doesn't last too long. She's crying. She's...
And it's fast and it's moving. You know?
No, it's a full orchestra. You know,
yeah.
And everyone's cheering. You know, he's got his hat off and it's
and
like...
This is where we get the ho, ho, ho. And you're like, oh, God, you fucking nailed it, you asshole.
Yeah. And smack. Almost, yeah. Almost hits the wall. That's okay. Composites look a little dated. You know, this stuff, the close-up stuff looks good.
Yeah.
But, you know, this stuff looks a little dated, you know.
Yeah.
But that's okay.
It's all right.
So, you know, this is the kind of stuff that even when Santa Claus is propelled into the modern times, well, he's not propelled, he gradually gets into modern times, but everything... At the North Pole, in his sleigh, with the reindeer, with him himself, stays classic, traditional, old-fashioned, you know? Nothing mm-hmm. changes. As compared to other Santa Claus movies, like what's that one called with Vince Vaughn? Fred Claus.
Fred Claus.
Fred Claus.
Yeah.
Or even Santa Claus or Elf. You know, the North Pole becomes modern looking and Santa Claus becomes modern. Like he has modern inventions on his,
he uses his actual technology.
Yeah. Like it feels so wrong. Like I remember there just being like TV and the sleigh and Santa Claus, or like a cocoa dispenser and stuff. And it's just like, seriously?
Seriously?
There's a rock.
Of progressing time, the montage of writing letters.
Oh, that's good. Yeah, that's good. They pick up the tradition. They started off without,
although I think they start giving us dates.
They do, yeah, on the hourglass.
Yeah
It goes from centuries, and this is their montage of how Santa Claus comes to be recognized in the modern world. You know, this is where we get reading and writing and reading and make a list, I'll be checking it twice.
I like this that they use their beards to paint.
I don't really.
Yeah, I like it. I like it.
It's kind of, yeah, it's nice.
It's a cute little touch.
It's cute.
They actually use themselves to make their mm-hmm. art. I
so
like
now
it.
We're in the 18th century. Can't you see he hates it? God, this kid's mean.
I know.
He's
Jesus.
Really hurting that cat.
I wanted to see a comeuppance of this kid. I wanted to see him get coal.
Yeah, give us a payoff or something.
Yeah,
like that.
Yeah, exactly. If they're gonna reference the naughty and nice,
yeah,
show
give us
a
scene where they're opening presents and he gets nothing or something, you know? Or
he should have gotten coal.
Coal in his stocking, yeah.
Yeah.
Did you like this? That the letters are actually lifted away magically.
It's all right. I don't dislike it.
Goes to the fireplace.
Turns into a cartoon.
Yeah.
It would have been difficult to do that with the technology at the time.
It's very difficult.
It would have looked like shit.
It would have. The cartoon's not so bad. It's okay.
See, I mean, this is it. They're actually taking time to address that kid was an asshole. But yet we don't see that kid not get anything. We really should have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think you're right. In retrospect, yeah. I mean, I've always had a problem with that scene because that kid is such a jerk. But
yeah.
You'll have folks saying I like
everyone
this.
Should get a present. Well, maybe we should change it.
I like this guy, this elf.
Yeah.
It's like
what's his name?
I can't remember. But it looks like he was born with those glasses on. You know, he's like born to wear them.
They did the "I'll be checking it twice."
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
That is like whoever the actor may be turning to camera and saying, you know, Bond, James Bond. It's like you got to nail that, dude.
Yeah, and you got to get that right.
He got it.
Yeah.
You know, although, you know, given what you just said about the fact that. In any most other Santa Claus type movies we've seen, when you know that they exist in modern time and back at the you know Keebler Village, they have the modern day type technologies to build the modern type toys. In this movie, up until modern day times, in this case the 80s, the elves are still producing the exact same kind of toys, and I think they would have progressed. Somehow, because kids
a little bit
don't really want this stuff anymore.
Yeah, I mean, as time went by, the kids' tastes would change in their letters, and they would write about different things. I mean, eventually they'd be writing about when they get to the 80s, they'd be writing about you know G.I. Joe and stuff. And
yeah, now I'm not saying I want to see these elves make G.I. Joes, but
no.
They could have made modern day toys just that weren't off the shelf action figures. They could have done something else.
This is the poem. It shook when he laughed
belly.
Like a bowl full of jelly. It's the cookies.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just a
is
poem.
That how they think I look?
And then I love this look he gets right here.
Oh, I know. Right. Here it is.
It's the cookies. And he's like,
He's so heartbroken.
I know. He's like, but I like the cookies.
He's like, don't take them from me.
Yeah. He's got to eat the vegetable. He's like,
That is quite an outfit he's wearing.
Getting close to modern times now.
Yep. Or
20th century.
Pretty much here. See, this is what I mean. These are, you know,
elf man.
These are nice toys when you're a little child, but past, you know, early elementary age, these toys aren't going to do it for you anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the modern day times that they take the movie to. Your soup's getting cold.
You know, have you ever thought about how long he actually takes to deliver? All the presents.
I don't think you can even think about it.
Well, I mean, because he does say endless night for you. And you can imagine, well, geez, I mean, is that just like years upon years?
Oh my God. It's beyond the ability to
do that? I mean, that would just be, I mean, good Lord. Does he get to take a break? You know, for some coffee, or does he get lunch, or does he need to eat, or what?
Yeah, and it is lunch a couple hundred years.
I know. What's the deal
and his
here?
His delayed thing. I know. You know, I don't know. Given that magic does seem to kind of quasi-exist in this world.
It does, because... Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead. I was going to... Well, I'll touch on it.
I would... If I had to answer that question, I would have to say that it's not literal for him. It's... Oh, gosh. It's like, you know, he could probably think back after it's all done and remember it all, but he probably doesn't experience it in a linear sense, you know? Mm-hmm. Because you'd go mad.
You know? You would. I mean, just like Bill Murray did in Groundhog Day. Eventually, yeah, he lost his mind.
I think there's an element of magic, you know? It's almost like his essence does all of it, mm-hmm. but... And it does take a long time, but not the eternity that, not the literal linear eternity that it would actually take.
Never see these two actors again.
No, you never see the boy.
Corny,
or the girl.
Corny?
Yeah.
Corny and Joe.
Joe, yeah.
Yeah. You know, our mother was watching this a couple of weeks ago. With your son. Yes. And she was telling me about it. I was like, wow, really? You watched the whole movie? She's like, oh, no. I turn it off right till they get to modern times. I turn it off. I was like, oh, really? I was like, I know it's sappy, but I stay for the whole thing every time.
Oh, yeah. There's good stuff in the modern stuff.
It's just like I said. It's just different. You know, it loses a certain charm to it, I guess you could say.
Right now, in reality, she closes blinds and go, Mother, call the police. There's a scummy boy looking at me.
It's only because her mother is so frustrating. If you think that your step-uncle
is going to stand for this kind of... Never. What year is this supposed to be? Because it looks Victorian.
Well, that's just the design. In that house. This house, anyway. But you clearly saw outside that it wasn't.
Yeah, I know. They should have probably addressed that. With all due
respect, sir. I have ideas that'll turn this place upside down.
That is not exactly...
Do you like the whole, you know, subplot? I mean, of... I guess it isn't really a sub... It's not really a subplot. I mean, this what becomes the actual...
Plot of the movie.
Yeah, it does. I mean, this whole assistant battle here seems just kind of like a sidestep, but it does lead to Patch leaving the North Pole and... joining up with BZ. I mean, do you really think this is where it, you know, just really starts to fall a little bit? And do you really like this competition? Do you think this was a good thing to put in the movie? This,
you know, here's the thing with it. I don't think it was a bad necessarily idea, but I don't think there was an actual payoff to it, because, you know, Patch loses the competition because he tries to automate
but
he tries to automate the system of making toys, and he takes the personality out of it. He turns it into an assembly line, and he doesn't, by the end of the movie, learn anything about that, you know, that he's a wonderful inventor, and that's great, but to not lose the hands-on touch, you know, and rather than do an assembly line, you know, maybe
that's just
he could move into a position where he teaches his fellow elves different ways to do the things, as opposed to an assembly line.
Yeah, sure.
But again, he doesn't. You know, he doesn't come full circle in a way.
No, he doesn't. No, he doesn't.
And given how much, I mean, this is a theme in the movie. Modern versus classic.
It is, and they don't wrap that up, and it's a mistake. I mean, this is obviously a commentary on modern society, and you see how these two things clash. Look here, he's trying to make an assembly line using old-fashioned technology, you know, and it doesn't work. Look, it's going to start to not work here in a few minutes. So,
but even if it had worked, they just wouldn't have the charm.
It doesn't. No, it loses its. It.
You know.
So I mean, I don't know why they dropped that thread. You know, because they obviously have it going through the movie, and the ending really doesn't have anything to do with that. It's all about defeating BZ. Exactly. And getting and saving Patch at the end. It's not about
saving Joe. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, Santa Claus runs into this. Many, you know, he runs into the fact that they can't keep up with modern technology in modern society. He's talking about. You can see it on his face that things have changed, and they address that in the movie, and then it goes nowhere. It just stops.
Yep.
It's a real shame. It's a real shame. You know. See, look, it's already breaking. It's not working. So. Yet these toys stay together, for some reason. I have no idea how. Without screws and bolts in there.
Yeah, there's no quality control here.
Mm-mm. There's no checkers. Yeah, what's going on? I think they'd be all over that, man. I think that'd be a part of, you know, somewhere down the line of the elf thing. You know, they'd be checkers. You know, stuff.
Yeah.
They don't have that.
Poor Puffy. Seems like they would have churned out a lot more than that. They're elves.
Yeah.
You know, like in the movie Elf, you know, how he can make a beautiful rocking chair out of the wood from their entertainment center.
You know, oh, yeah, right.
He's a brilliant toy maker, you know. Slow by Earth standard or slow by elf standards, but ridiculously fast by human standards. Hold the fort. Be right back.
Could have done it without this scene in McDonald's. I'm kind of sad to see Justin leave during this scene because it's such an important scene. Those Sulkins love to put product in their movies, and this is incredibly blatant. It could have been anywhere, a nondescript restaurant. No, it is a McDonald's. And everyone's so happy eating their McDonald's. Big McDonald's sign. He's looking through the golden arch, you know. Come on, seriously? Not necessary. Reeks of product placement. I like this. This is cute. This is kind of cute. You know, this little romance between the two of them. Although it's completely... fantasy. It's complete fantasy. It would never happen in real life. But, you know, she would more or less be frightened by him, not attracted to him, I don't think. You know, she would be like Justin referred to him, you know, a bomb across. Call the police! Now!
There's a vagabond in my yard.
Be gone, vagabond! Yeah, she prominently...
Yeah, take this food, boy.
She prominently...
The odd smell is normal.
She leaves poison. Of course, she leaves him a Coke.
Yeah,
you can see that you walked out on the McDonald's scene, brother.
Yeah, I know.
But that was too bad. But I love the way he eats this food. He always makes it look, God, so good.
Yeah, he takes it down.
I want to eat it. You know.
Yeah. Now, at least the beginning of this stuff with the kids, I actually like it. It's nice.
Yeah, it's cute. I was mentioning that.
You know, it works.
Yeah. For the most part. Yeah, it's cute. Like I said, it's complete fantasy, though.
They go too far.
Yeah.
But it starts well, you know. Yeah, I wonder why we never saw either of these kids again. They did okay.
I'm not sure. They just gave up acting. That's not the first time that's happened.
Yeah, true.
Well, now I want the score to this movie. Going well,
eh? I just love the image of Santa and his sleigh. Absolutely love it.
Even the fake sparklies are okay.
I could have done without those.
Yeah, well, I'm used to it. See, this just doesn't, you know, flying over the city doesn't...
Doesn't do it for you?
See, you know, they really do... This is one thing I was going to mention earlier. They really do teeter on the edge of whether or not Santa Claus is real. I guess in this universe, he is. In this world, he is. People believe in Santa. It seems to be something... It's common knowledge. You know what I'm talking about? It's not a myth of, like, whether or not he exists or not. Santa Claus is a real guy.
If I understand what you're saying, I don't think I agree.
From the many times I've watched this, where are you getting that? That's just been my impression growing up and watching it over the years, is that in this world, Santa Claus is a real entity. Is from what I
and he's not considered a myth. They look up and go, "Oh, there's Santa again."
Well, I mean,
Must be Christmas.
I mean, maybe they don't see him or whatever, but
they know he's a fact.
I mean, Patch ends up competing against him. You know, Patch puts stuff under trees too. I mean, it's something common to them. They don't ask where it comes from.
That's the problem with any Santa Claus movie is, you know, obviously the parents know, well, I didn't put that there, you know, so it's one of those things you can't think about. I don't think it by default means that Superman, that Santa Claus is a fact as opposed to a myth. I don't think he should ever be thought of as fact. You know, that everyone knows there is a real guy at the North Pole somewhere. No. Wrong.
I don't know. Like I said, that's just, you know, what I saw.
Lucky little shit. He just happened to be the one.
Right place at the right time.
You know, now he gets to go on the best ride ever.
You know, he kind of reminds me of Darren from Explorers.
Yeah, I can see that.
A little bit.
Yo. You know, what I love about Huddleston is that, and this is a hard balance to strike, is that he balances, you know, that like overwhelming Boy Scout goodness with, he's not a pushover either, you know. It's like he can be tough if he needs to be. You know, there's a sternness to him, but it's not intimidating. It's hard to explain that. But, you know, he wouldn't put up with people's shit, you know. And you see it on, you could just look at Huddleston's face. Like, you know, if he yelled at you, that would be really tough.
He does yell in the Wonder Years.
Yeah, exactly. You know, it's a really delicate line, and he rides it very, very well.
Yeah. I've been trying for years. Well, maybe tonight's
the night. Come on, daughter. Let's give it that old college try. Yeah, see, I don't know if I like the image of seeing the sleigh over New York City.
No, I don't particularly like it either. I mean, I can see Superman flying around in it, sure, but...
Of course.
Santa Claus is a different entity altogether.
Yeah, I don't know how you address that. I don't know if there's a way you can. Maybe just see him going over, you know, residential places as opposed to a big city.
Yeah.
That would probably help.
Yeah.
The super duper looper.
That's a thread.
That comes back.
Comes back.
Pay attention.
Yeah. So what do you think about this, you know, Santa Claus befriending Joe? You know, what do you think about that? I kind of like, you know, I don't like it really, you know. No, I mean, like I said, we've said, you know,
I don't mind it in concept.
The second and third act have some problems.
Yeah,
but I do kind of like the two of them together. They, you know.
Yeah,
what I mean?
They do have a little something.
Yeah, they do, and that's what makes it fun to watch.
See, you know, Joe's a kid of the streets. Now, granted, that it's not like they spent tremendous amount of screen time doing this, but...
And why did he decide to suddenly stop now?
Like, he's the first homeless person.
Yeah,
I know.
I'm like, this is New York he's flying over. There's homeless people all over the place.
They're everywhere.
Like, you got to be kidding me.
Yeah. No, but I think part of their chemistry is that, you know, he's supposed to be a kid of the streets and a little tougher.
But he melts when it comes to
Santa. And Huddleston is able to give him a little bit of that toughness in his voice and in his mannerisms to kind of win him over rather than just be super sweet Santa Claus. You know what I mean?
Yeah. But at the same time, I mean, you do get to see the Joe character kind of melt, you know, when it comes to Santa, because he is still a kid, you know. It's amazing.
He bites those kids later on. He's like, no, he's real.
Yeah, I mean, you saw how harsh he was at first, you know. I'm pitching a no-hitter for the Yankees. What's it look like I'm doing, you know?
Yeah.
You know, he kind of turns to, you know, he warms his heart, the cockles of his heart a little bit.
I wish I could have seen it, like an Easter egg in here and seen Zod and Superman flying by somewhere in the back.
Come on, kill him. Kill him.
Just something so subtle, like you know, R2-D2's been put into various little bits that ILM has done, you know, just a little wink.
You know. It's like, yeah, fun's over. Give me the reins.
Yeah, it's like, all right, that was enough.
Oh, yeah!
And see, this is a problem with what they've done now. He's taken Joe off the street for a night, shown him around, and then he's basically going to dump him back into homelessness again.
Basically, yeah. So
it's like, well, thanks for the gift, Dick.
It's, you know? It's the same kind of thing that Superman runs into. You know, you can't save everyone necessarily.
Well, no, you can't, but he stopped for this one, so he really shouldn't send him back into the streets.
Exactly. He should take him home.
He should have
brought
him back right away.
Yeah.
Because it kind of makes him look like a douche.
Yeah, it's like, where do you think he's going to go?
Exactly.
Well, no, well, not necessarily.
Oh, you gave him a cookie. That'll feed him for a while.
Well, he does leave him with Corny, though. So, you know, that's...
He can't possibly believe that...
Yeah, you know, yeah, that's true.
...that they're going to take care of him.
Yeah,
I think they should have addressed that.
It's a problem. It is a problem, yeah. Yeah.
Well.
I'm sorry. So happens they... Well, I guess they would have ended up here anyway. See, I wonder how long he's been with him. You know, has the endless night been endless for him, too? You can see BZ right there. Can you see him?
Where?
In the frame behind Santa Claus.
Oh, yeah.
You saw him?
And the big picture is him, the painting, isn't it?
Well, yeah, but I guess they don't show it in its full frame right now. But that picture there. Well, yeah, see, his head's cut off. Can't see it. Yeah. This is very Victorian. Yeah.
Too much.
A little too much, yeah. Yeah, she's a little too enamored with him, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah, too much so.
Yeah. She is kind of cute, though.
Oh, she is.
Yeah.
Sure.
But, chocolate chip. They're my favorite. So maybe just that's how he eats all throughout the whole endless night of centuries of delivering presents. It's the milk of cookies that keeps him going.
Yeah, he should have been like, I don't feel so good. I need some protein.
Santa can't drink any more milk. Santa has a lactose intolerance. Do you want to see Santa farting down everybody's chimneys?
Funny, but not classic.
No.
Excellent. Come on, Angie. At least we get to see them using the toys, the classic toys here in modern times.
You think?
They're doing it right now.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I know. But do you think it was a good idea, really? Is what I meant. Oh. That's what that sounds like. Oh.
It's a piece of crap.
Oh, yeah, he just kicks it to the curb.
Everyone's got a Santa toy.
I know. It's like, oh, man.
Now that bus, that... Oh, well, it's because it broke off of the handle.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know.
You believe in Santa, we're going to beat you up. Mm. Oh, I love this scene. You can see her mouthing her lines. Watch. Do you know? Did you ever realize that? Watch. Watch.
No.
Watch. It's coming up. It's coming up. The girl wearing the green sweater.
Oh, yeah.
You see it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Soon, yeah. I'm like, you couldn't find another take? What's going on? The clock seemed behind schedule there.
Returns. We've never gotten returns.
Returns are coming back from everywhere. Yeah, see, I mean, wouldn't all these parents wonder where all these toys came from?
Yeah, see, it's one of those things. You
just don't question.
You can't. How do you question that in a Santa Claus movie? You can't.
Yes.
You just have to suspend disbelief and,
I love
and
this,
move on.
I love this apron. I love his apron. It just Patch's apron. I want an apron like that because it says assistant on it. You know, it's just like if I was an assistant at a job, I would, you know, I'd want to wear that just because it's, I don't know, it's fun. It's so
goofy. I like Santa's outfit right here. His casual dad.
His casual wear.
This feels more appropriate than the spotted one.
Yeah, I suppose.
It's under there, but, you know, it's like exaggerated with all the sew lines and everything.
Yeah, yeah. Red just isn't my color. Such a sad moment.
Yeah.
This really is a heartbreaking moment. I mean, I didn't mean to be talking light about it, but it really is. And then he gives the thing to Puffy, and he gets to watch. It's just, it's heartbreaking. It really is. It's really sad. There's a score piece going on here.
It is, and that's what we were talking about. There's no payoff to this.
No, there's
you know, there should have been a you know, come back to this, you know.
Well, yeah, because I mean, he's going through a crisis of faith here, of character in himself, and
yeah, basically
he regains that through BZ, but he's doing that because he believes that he's betrayed Santa Claus, that he's lost the faith. Santa Claus has lost faith in him, but he never really has, and it's all resolved in this bizarre climax where they have to do a super duper looper, and the candy canes are going to blow up, and but it isn't really resolved. They're just brought back together, and everyone's just happy for some reason.
Yeah.
He should still be depressed and like, man, but I still screwed up big time, you know?
Well, like I said, it would have been nice if he came around and realized that the level of, you know, automation he was striving for robs the presence of their magic, you know? I love that the reindeer's crying. That was good.
You don't think that was a bit much?
No, I liked it. I liked it. He has a special connection to these creatures, and clearly
he's been the one taking care of them, yeah.
and you know, these are magical creatures, all of them, mm-hmm. So that's okay, he can cry.
So
see you later, buddy.
Hope you find your dad. So unlike, you know, Christopher Reeve, you know, who walked to the North Pole apparently in Superman 2,
right,
he does not walk, he just zaps there. So
yeah, kind of, he like teleports.
Oh, an hour in, John Lithgow. This is God, he's so good. Even before he said anything, he was eating the frame.
He knows exactly what he's doing.
Oh yeah.
You know, he never wavers. He plays this character the same way consistently through the whole movie. He doesn't go from over the top to subtle to whatever. He plays this guy the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a testament to his ability. He knows what he's doing. He knows how this is going to look and sound, and he can't break. He has to be right. This guy all the time.
Yeah. Wait. Here comes the best part. Look at this. Glass and sand.
Nails.
And nails to make it jingle. That is awesome.
I wish my subtitles could work. I don't recall exactly what he's saying.
My subtitles aren't on either. Yeah.
Astonished than you are to see this, and I can guarantee that if these are not isolated examples, I'll make sure that they
will never happen again.
Happen again.
Just look at him. He doesn't need to talk. He can just do it with his face.
See, I guess you could say, I mean, you would think that when it transitions into modern times that it maybe that's where the transition starts, but it really starts here, I guess.
It does.
He is clearly the villain, and he's a mustache twirler.
Now, look at his outfit, what he's wearing. Mm. It feels a little more classic.
It does.
It makes me think that possibly
Kane-esque.
An option here
would
have been to have the quote-unquote modern-day conflict not be quite so modern. Have it be in the future from when we first encounter Santa Claus, but not in our actual... Maybe around the times when they were starting to develop automation and things like that. Then it would feel a little more like a period piece.
Like in the early, you know... 20th century, or maybe
in
the 30s,
something
like that.
Yeah. So there's the A-Team van, by the way.
Oh yeah, of course.
So
is that actually the A-Team van?
That's the friggin' A-Team van.
I mean, was that on purpose?
I clearly, you don't just accidentally put that there. That's the A-Team band. But see, like the way he's dressed until a second ago, that doesn't necessarily clash with the old school Santa Claus stuff. So if they had put it back a little bit, you could have dealt with that theme of automation coming in and its effect without it being drenched in the 80s.
Yeah, you know, that's true.
I think that would have been an option. You could still have kind of the same conflict, only it would have been a little more meaningful.
Well, yeah, look at the way look at his shoes. That's very kind of 20s.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. Like 20s. That would have been a great way.
Yeah. I mean, you could even put it in the Depression era, you know. I mean, think about it. Look at The Untouchables. That was made in the 80s, takes place in the early 30s. If it was in that time period, much more believable. Much more believable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Exactly. I mean, look at his TV. Look at that.
Yeah, it's kind of round.
That's beyond old.
Yeah,
you know,
very old-fashioned.
That they're making a decorative statement there. This is they got their styles all over the place.
You mean like a fairy? I liked
John Lithgow is freaking tall. Next
well,
time.
He's very short, but I loved the introduction of Patch here when the lighting they had in that chair. It's a very soft, it's very ethereal light, and it's you got to imagine that's all practical. That's a practical setup. There was no alteration, at least I don't think, because it's just the lighting on that chair. You know,
well, you can see it. It's still there.
Yeah, it was it did make him look very mystical. You were probably a naughty boy. You know, as much as funny as that is, you know, I probably was no angel. You know, wouldn't Patch right now run and be like, I should not be involved with this guy?
Yeah, it would have been better if BZ played him a little better. And
yeah,
took advantage of his naivete.
Because he just said, I'm evil, and he still works with him.
You're right.
Oh. Yeah, it doesn't make any sense, but oh well. You gotta give it that. Advertise? How do I do that? It's talking about advertising right now. Television works best. Smokes the cigar well. Yeah, those electronic picture boxes.
Yes, I mean, he is taking advantage of the fact that Patch doesn't really know much about the modern world.
Yeah, he said money. I don't know much about that. Good.
But like you said, you know, he's very clearly a villain.
Obviously.
And Patch would just rebel against
him. I mean,
like,
there's only so much naivete you could swallow, you know, from Patch, you know.
Yeah.
Although the way he said fortune.
Yeah. Fortune?
That would cost a fortune. Give more kisses to get bigger hugs.
All of them.
Well, here comes the best part.
Christmas 2.
Oh, not that part. I mean this part. It's coming up, but
you know, if they had placed this back, you know, in an earlier time, they could have had the people who buy the toy. Well, nothing. We're going to give them away free. He turns red.
Yeah, I know.
The lighting actually hits him.
Yeah.
free.
That's not how it works here in a free enterprise system. But immediately you see his wheels are turning. It's like, wait a minute, this could be good for me. Yeah.
You know, had they taken it back to an earlier date, still what we would technically call modern day times, but you know, from you know, our ancient perspective, you know, that Santa Claus was found in, you know, it's quite a bit later. But if BZ, the character of BZ, whether his name was still that or not, they could have had him appear to be a benevolent type of guy, you know, rich miser type guy, and that's what Patch believes, you know. But here he's so blatantly bad, you know. And to really pull the wool over Patch's eyes, he could have had a certain appearance, almost like a Lex Luthor appearance to him, where Lex Luthor wants to look like the hero to the world, so he does all these things to make him look good, but at the end of the day he's still Lex Luthor. I think they should have possibly gone that road. You know, the more I talk about it, the more I like it, that they should have had it take place, these modern-day stuff, you know, like in the 30s, 20s, maybe.
Well, I know I've said it. I agree.
Yeah.
But this is the movie we have. So.
I know.
What are you going to do? And as much as I disagree with their choices in a lot of respects, I still love the movie.
I do too.
I will always love the movie for all of its cheesiness.
I watch it every year.
Every year I watch it.
I never don't enjoy it.
Yeah, it's not the classic that National Lampoon's Vacation, Patch Office. Do you see that?
Yeah, that's good. Dispatch.
It's not the classic that National Lampoon's Vacation is, or Christmas Story, or It's a Wonderful Life, or, you know. But
look at Christmas Story. Exactly. Look how that movie looks.
Yeah.
If that had taken place in that universe, this wouldn't have seemed like such a conflict. You see what I mean? Exactly. That was what, the 30s, wasn't it?
Well, I think it was the 40s. But
maybe the 40s, yeah. But still, it you know.
I like Puce.
I like that guy. He's funny.
Yeah.
Everyone's got to have a bloody sidekick, man. Every evil guy has to have his henchman.
Yep.
You know, Ned Beatty.
Yeah, yeah. That's an elf portrait.
Yeah. I like that
he's still a craftsman.
Making something. Yeah.
By hand, yeah.
He should have said, God, I haven't done one of these in a long time. I miss this, you know. If anything, that should have fed in to the one of the major themes of the movie, which is that, you know, the automation and getting your hands off of physically doing things, you know. Mm-hmm. This should have sent a message to himself going, oh, that's what went wrong. You know, we need to do this. We need to be bigger and faster, yes, but we can't lose the touch.
Yeah, if someone gave me a gift like that they carved by hand out of a block of wood,
hell,
I would be like, this is the best gift I've ever gotten in my life.
That is priceless.
Yeah, that is priceless. Yeah. You can't wrap that up. I mean, all that time that they spent making it.
No, you can't.
You can't put that in a box and wrap it in a bow and call it a day. It's not the same thing. That is great. That's a present, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, boy. Patch. Mm.
Yeah.
Little Paul doesn't look anything like this. Mm. Look at this, man. He's like, oh, man. Man, this guy's going to get it. Mm-hmm.
I know. Why? Of all the Christmas commercials, that's the one he locks on to?
Uh-huh.
Come on now. They're taking it awfully personally.
Oh, yes. Very personal. Well, because they've met the man.
Well, I understand that, but there's Christmas ads all over the place.
This is where we
find
out.
Why does that one bring about such venom?
Yeah, this is the one where we find out that...
See, that Uncle Scrooge, you know, it...
Merry Christmas, Uncle.
He knows what movie he's in. You know, that's
a, oh yeah, look at that.
He knows exactly.
Cracks his knuckles and
what it is.
Smoking. He's always smoking that cigar. See, they have a TV in here, and it feels wrong, even though it's surrounded by a frame.
Yeah, tricky stuff.
Yeah.
What do you do? A friggin' snow globe, like, you know, Wizard of Oz?
No, I mean, at least they'd be like far behind in technology, where there'd be somebody to telegraph, you know, you know,
I don't
beeping
know.
Out the message.
Tricky one.
Yeah.
Where is it? Yeah.
They've just gone a little too far here. This is
they sure did.
Yeah.
Knock 'em dead, boy. Knock 'em dead.
Yeah, Patch's car is... Yeah. So this was what he's making the whole time. This is the delivery system. Yeah. He's pumping in the fairy dust or whatever it is. They never call it anything, do they?
I don't think so. Darn it. See now, what? What's actually going on here? See now, he offered BZ a product that everyone would want and would be basically free to make.
He's trying to clean up his image, that's all.
Well, But why do it like this? Why does he need to deliver them in this fashion? You know, this is direct competition with Santa Claus, which Patch doesn't. That doesn't seem to be his motivation. Why would he do this?
He wants to be seen as a Santa Claus type figure. So a lollipop magically appearing underneath the tree. There you go. He becomes a Santa Claus.
But see, they never did anything or had him say anything that made him seem like that's quite. He just wanted to advance things. He just wanted to do that. This is kind of a different motivation to me.
I don't know if I can go with you. I think it's quite clear what he's doing.
Oh, it's clear what he's doing, but I don't think his motivations support it. Is what I'm saying.
Well, I think so.
I don't think the character of Patch that we have come to know would do this. I think he would look at us and go, I can't do that. That's Santa Claus's job. You know? It seemed more likely that BZ would, because BZ's not profiting from this. This is the problem. BZ wants a profit, so he needs to sell these things.
At least somebody does.
So Patch is giving them away.
Yeah, but he's not going to make a profit on this. He knows that.
BZ?
Yeah.
It's going to lead to bigger things.
Yeah, he's just doing this to clean up his image. He knows that. He's just planting the seed right now, and then he's going to fuck the plant.
then I think he should have talked Patch into delivering it like this, and have Patch be like, "Look, that's like worshiping another god, man. I don't know if I can do that." But BZ should have really coerced him into delivering things this way. I mean, do you see what I'm saying? I think Patch would have taken, you know, a moral offense to delivering things in this manner, which is so clearly Santa Claus's.
He should have taken, an offense to BZ's character from the start.
Well, yes, we've already addressed that.
Well, yeah.
Hello, homeless child. What have you been doing for the past year? It's a miracle you're alive.
He's had a shower. He's clean, for the most part.
Where have you been living? Oh, off of scraps. I feel like an asshole.
Yeah, glad you didn't die. Well, okay. Yeah. Well, see you next year. Bye. Stay warm.
Exactly. How did he find him anyway?
Yeah.
Does he have like a Santa Claus version of Cerebro, like an X-Men, where you can just locate him?
Cerebro.
Oh, that's your present. It's not food or shelter, but yeah, it should be nice.
It'll no way keep you warm or feed you or anything.
Fill
like
your
that.
Belly. It's not even an address to a homeless shelter.
No, not even for me.
I'll put in a good word for you. Yeah. Not. Thanks.
Excellent. Did Corny get something? Yeah, so by the way, Joe, it must suck not having, you know, a mother and father or anyone to talk to. Or
yeah, where are they, by the way?
What's going on? You know, yeah. So what's school like? Oh, I forgot. You don't go. Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Can you even write?
Can you spell my name? No.
Yeah.
What about the...
And you smell like shit. Your clothes stink. Very
nice. I'll clean you up a little bit. Jeez. You mind? All right. Seriously, get out. Get out. Get out of the sleigh right now.
You're offending me. Is this the only place he goes?
See,
New York?
Oh, yeah, apparently. At least in... Yeah, modern visits, but... If you don't want it, then I'll just be ashamed to let it go to a waste. And she just chews it.
Yeah, she like takes that thing down.
Yeah. It's a soft pop, apparently.
Yeah.
You see, that's what I mean. They don't question the fact that they can fly. They believe in magic
know,
in this world, you know?
It's a tricky little thing.
I feel like that, Mary Poppins.
That they definitely needed...
This kid, you know, dunks the ball, you know, and they definitely see what I mean. You see, they believe in magic in this world.
I know, like that, you know.
This is unexplainable. Unexplainable,
I agree.
Sir.
I agree. They shouldn't have done this at all. They should have had the candy canes do something else, because this is obviously, you know, you can only stretch.
Puce pop conquers the world. What?
Yeah, puce pop. Your suspension of disbelief, you can only suspend so much, yes, when they're blatantly flying.
Mm-hmm.
And BZ would never put Patch in front of the TV like this, ever.
Yeah, this is his...
He would keep well, because Patch, his little secret.
Yeah, Patch is taking the spotlight away.
You exactly.
Know, he wants to be... He's the one who's given these, not Patch, you know?
Precisely.
There's no secret behind this, you know? There's no elf running things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, they'll have to write to Santa Claus just like the other boys and girls. What we want
is to... Yeah, even as a conflict, as much a conflict as it is, I mean, I wouldn't say it's an incredibly strong one. I mean, he and Santa Claus don't ever really go toe-to-toe or anything like that.
Thank God.
No. You know, no fisticuffs fighting or, him and his limo versus the
Lee Majors.
Sleigh. Lee Majors, the $6 million man.
Yeah,
the reindeer died.
Yeah, you can't have Santa Claus busting in kicking ass. It doesn't work.
Mm-mm.
At all.
And what was that business about our future plans?
See, this is where he's like, okay, now we've got the attention of the world. Now we've got them in our palm of our hands.
This is Christmas too.
This is Christmas too, yeah.
Send for me to come home.
Well, why would you want to do that? What does the North Pole have that New York doesn't? Ice and polar bears.
And Santa Claus and my friends.
See, he wants to go back now. So, I mean, does he think that he's won? He thinks he's won the...
He thinks the commercials and all that have probably got Santa Claus's attention.
Yeah, it's just really went the wrong way. Well, I guess that's part of his growth, I guess. You know, they went the wrong way about it, you know.
But like we've pointed out, it go anywhere. You know, there needs to be a scene of understanding.
Yeah, like,
of,
you know,
of where he went wrong.
Yeah,
and
you know,
why.
Like I took a misstep. I allied myself with an insidious human being. You know?
This
stardust, this reindeer cornflakes, whatever it is that made the children walk on air.
I wonder if Lithgow has any recollections of this.
I would like to hear it.
I would like to hear from Lithgow. One of the things this thing is missing is, I mean, the commentary on it's fine. Gino is a little odd.
Yeah, I would like a commentary by someone a little more lucid.
Yeah.
Wouldn't take you long.
But just to hear from these actors again would be nice. This is a modern day.
To have Huddleston and Lithgow on this would be a treasure.
Yeah, that'd be nice. I mean, it was a long time ago. It might be difficult for them to remember certain things, but...
Patch! You are some terrific elf! I mean,
you know, it's a shame I never saw Lithgow do this kind of a thing again. Because he is really good at it.
He started playing a lot of villains at this point.
Did he really?
Yeah, like, you know, Cliffhanger and what was that other one with Denzel?
He was also in Buckaroo Banzai.
Buckaroo, I mean, you know.
Yeah, that's true. He was very over the top in that. Yeah.
You know, he seems to have unfortunately stopped playing these over the top guys, which he did so well. In favor of darker bad
guys.
Well,
he came back to that with Third Rock from the Sun.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess you could say that.
Yeah. Although he did give a great performance, a terrified performance in the Twilight Zone movie.
Mm-hmm.
I think probably the only sequence in that movie that actually outperforms the original.
Definitely.
Yeah.
He had a recurring part in one of the seasons of Dexter.
Isn't this where he's saying it right here? I mean,
maybe I've fallen behind.
It's like, you know, that look when you give someone a present, you know, the look in their eyes, you know, this is where he's talking about the disconnect.
But
that
it
it's gone.
Has no
now.
Resolution.
Yeah.
He acknowledges it.
He's talking about he feels useless now in this world. That's
right.
He's like, I have no purpose anymore. You know, nobody cares about me.
Yeah.
And it really does not conclude. And it's a shame because it's a really nice concept. And when
that should have been the conflict of the movie.
Yeah, you see the sadness on his wife's face. You know, she doesn't know what to tell him. You know, she realizes it's not the way it used to be.
Yeah.
And what do you do about that? You know. I mean, they did kind of touch upon that, even though, I mean, it's not quite the same thing. In Elf, you know, when they all start singing at the end.
The sleigh won't fly without Christmas spirit.
I mean, the whole Christmas spirit meter was silly, stupid.
Yeah, oh, I agree.
It was bad. You know, the rocket engine on it was stupid.
I know.
Modern technology should not be on it, but whatever.
Ever.
Ever at all, yeah. So, he built all of this?
Yeah.
I guess. So, where does this stuff come from? I mean, he must make it. You know, he makes the glitter dust or elf dust or whatever, I guess. They never explain where it comes from or how it's produced.
No, he brought it with him.
Yeah, but he has to make more of it to put on all these candy canes and lollipops.
Probably doesn't take much.
Well, no, look, no, that's right. He's reaching into his bag right now.
Yeah.
So...
Yeah, it's not like he intends to stay there. He always intended to go back.
I guess that's true.
Like you said, once Santa Claus respected him, you know, so he didn't need an endless supply. You know, that those two scoops he pulled out would probably make.
Probably should keep it in a more secure location. He just has it in a little filing cabinet.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
Nobody ever goes down there.
I find it kind of hard to believe that the mother was never wise to this kid.
What, you know, living there?
Coming in and out, you know, just that she would never notice, you know? Right. It's, come on, really? Oh, yeah, Puffy with the doll. Can it fly? No, sir, it wets.
It wets.
This is sad. It's these guys. Like, can you cheer him up? Can you cheer him up, please? He's so sad.
A doll. Children ought to like it.
Does it fly?
It.
I wonder if they took a stab at this, you know, nowadays. You know?
What, if making this movie?
Same concept, you know. How would it come out? You know, would it be infused with more modern sensibilities? You know, modern technology, would it be even worse? Or, you know, I would like to see what the Salkinds would do. You know,
Want to see the Salkinds do it.
I would like to see. I mean, I wouldn't want to see them do it, but I'd like to see what time would have done to them. You know, if they would still make it in the same fashion. Same goes for, like, Supergirl, you know, they would still make that the same way, you know?
Right. Probably not.
I didn't dare use a phone, BC. I couldn't take the chance of anyone hearing.
Hearing what?
Shh.
Hearing what?
Are we alone?
Huh. My niece and her nanny are fast asleep.
All right. Good. Come on.
This is where it kind of goes astray for a little while.
Yeah, it does, unfortunately. I mean, this is the third act, and... it's probably the least interesting act, unfortunately. By the third act, things should really be moving along in a nice clip. But, you know, I mean, as fun as Lithgow is to watch, you know, it's like we've said, he's just in a different movie by himself altogether. Yeah. And it has nothing to do with Santa Claus. And it's jarring, you know.
It is.
Santa Claus is finished.
I mean, I you know, watching Lithgow, it's like, you know, I'd really like to see just a whole movie kind of about BZ, you know.
Yeah, you know, movie just with BZ would have been interesting.
Yeah, but you know, it's a tribute to Lithgow, I think, of how good he is in this movie that he doesn't come in until the hour mark. I mean, it was 1 hour on the dot when he came in. And he has such a big impression in this movie that it feels like he's in a lot more. But he's really not, you know? less than an hour of screen time in this movie, but he eats up every second he has, and he has a big impression.
Yeah, he sure does.
See, he kidnaps Joe here, and why? Oh, because Joe heard everything, that's right.
Yeah.
That's why he handcuffs him in the basement. That's right here when he's hearing it, yeah.
I'll deal with him later.
I wonder what it must feel like to be an actor and ham it up to that extent, you know, when you know you're hamming it up.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, what that must feel like to do, you know, must be
fun.
It must be just a complete joy, I can imagine.
Yeah.
To be able to just go so off the beaten path and just be completely ludicrous, you know, not serious, you know.
Well, yeah, you can kind of make it up as you go. You know, that there are no rules as far as your behavior. You can just do whatever the hell you want.
Uh-huh.
I love it. Why? Stop making me say this. Uh-huh, uh-huh. I sound like a damn moron.
Damn it, Towser, get on with your story. Stop giving me all these short sentences and making me go...
And then he goes on. He's like, uh-huh.
I had to move one of the batches of candy canes to another...
He's always chomping on those cigars.
...box next to a radiator in the lab.
And...
There's no more lab.
Yeah, the only thing he is missing is a mustache to twirl, basically.
Yeah.
Stop this.
Stop! Are you insane?
Well, see, the plot thickens. Now she hears it.
Most of it in cash. Cash, man! Small, unmarked bills.
You see, now this is where she clearly takes steps to have Santa rescue her. You know, she knows this letter is going to be taken up in a way, you know. That's where I get the feeling that they just...
I agree. They shouldn't go that way. We shouldn't see those kinds of things. It makes it too literal.
Yeah, well...
You can't do that in a movie where there's magical stuff. You can't.
And who appreciates them better than I? These industrious... little boys and girls, saving all their nickels and dimes.
I'm not saying I have another solution right now, but you can't do it.
No.
They'll get what they...
Yeah, it would be an interesting experiment to see.
You know, it would have been just as easy for her to, well, assuming it was on Christmas Day, you know, for her to just stay up all night and wait for him to show up.
I suppose. You know? Yeah, I suppose.
Then the magic of it is...
Yeah, just to see her pacing around the living room waiting for him to show up or something like that.
Yeah.
Well, no, wait, this isn't Christmas. No, it's not. It's not
No,
Christmas.
I know it's not. That's what I'm saying. They could have done that and had it take place on Christmas Day.
Well, unfortunately, they can't really do that. I mean, another year would have had to have
Christmas
gone
Eve.
By.
Yeah.
You know? And they can't. I mean, they clearly state it's only been like a month or something like that. So, yeah, another year would have had to gone by and Patch wouldn't have stuck around for that long. That just wouldn't have worked. Everything looks comfortable except for this part. You know, he rolls the thing on top of him like
yeah.
that. Like, that's not a blanket. That's a hood.
Yeah, you're going to chop your neck off.
Yeah.
This is kind of real.
Yeah, it's a little too real.
It's a little too, yeah.
I mean, yeah, they've tied him to the pipe. They've gagged
him.
He's
like pulling his head, you know. That's a little harsh in a Santa Claus movie.
Of mine. Cornelia, what are you doing? You're 10 minutes late for breakfast.
It looked like Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer font on her letter. Well, whatever.
I didn't notice.
Yeah, well, I've seen that movie many times. So. See, there it goes. Oh.
Just what I thought.
See, the movie just, it's falling apart.
Unfortunately, so.
All the things that were working are conflicting now.
Well, it's because it's lost that, you know, the juxtaposition that they were going for, you know. It's all about BZ now.
Yeah.
And BZ comes in at the 1 hour mark. He can't carry this by himself. And then all Santa is doing is just sitting around moping. It's not about Santa and a Claus anymore. It's about BC.
Exactly.
And you're like, well, that's okay, but you know, this movie is called Santa Claus. So, you know, get back to Santa Claus, please.
Yeah.
And Santa Claus becomes a supporting character in his own movie.
Yeah.
Right now. You know, it's
fallen totally flat.
It's Dudley Moore and John Lithgow heading the movie, and he comes in to save the day at the end, and that's pretty much it, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, this is cool. He's back in his garb. All right. You know, he's going to go save the day. Fine. But that's pretty much all he gets to do for the rest of the movie. That's it. Mm-hmm. Sadly.
Yeah, it doesn't have to do with him actually being Santa.
I know we're too
much. Yeah, no.
No conflict about, you know, do I want to do this forever or what's happening to the world? Nothing like that.
Can you do it for little Joe?
He's only out with 6 reindeer, isn't he?
Yeah, 2 are down.
Yeah, they do the looped super duper looper with only 6.
Yeah, maybe 8 was just too many. Too much of a good thing.
Way down the front.
Yeah exactly. All right, man. Threw off their aerodynamics.
Yeah, right.
All the toys are pretty much gone, too.
Well, that's because it's the beginning of the year. Everything's
is that
gone.
What it is?
Yeah, it's because this is like January, so they haven't replenished their stock. Yeah. See, I liked how real that looked. You know, when you saw them, that camera shot from inside the sleigh, when you see the reindeer running.
Yeah.
You don't see that in other Christmas movies nowadays. You don't get that.
No.
You don't get that feeling. See, now Patch becomes involved with Joe, and it's just like,
it's just lost
Santa Claus in all of this business?
It's called Santa Claus the Movie.
Yeah. Ace. I mean, even in the extras, I remember Dudley Moore hosting it. You know, he says, oh, well, you know, we're telling Santa Claus's life story here.
No, not
really. Not in this part.
For the first hour.
Yeah,
maybe.
At least for that part anyway.
You dumb punk.
I just wanted him to see what a good assistant I could be.
He's seen what you are. You're a dummy, stupid-headed, stink-faced creep who made the kids.
Yeah, because Santa Claus is the only one that could have possibly made this.
Exactly, yeah.
Although it's supposed to be him.
Oh, yeah, it's supposed to be Patch, yeah.
Doesn't really look like him, though.
No. Nope, but that was a nice touch, though. You know, that he made the elf portrait out of Patch without realizing it. That was a nice touch.
Yeah, even the wife pointed out. She's like,
oh, it's Patch. She's like, oh, I guess it is. Yeah, that was a nice touch.
Yeah.
See, now she's pacing. Yeah, okay.
It's lost its way entirely. Santa Claus doesn't go on rescue missions.
Santa Claus doesn't appear.
I'm just going to get in your sleigh. Like, it means nothing.
Yeah, you think she'd be like, oh, wow, this is great.
She'd be like, holy shit, this is real.
Are we flying right now? Oh, my God. And, you know, Santa Claus is out during the daylight. He's out.
Yeah,
they're breaking too many rules. It's not Christmas time. He's just out in the normal business hours. You know,
Yeah.
Good, huh? He kind of took to Patch really quickly.
Yeah.
This is just gone. It's gone.
Wrong.
They really should have thought twice, 3 times, 4 times while writing this that this was not going to work.
Yeah.
I really don't know what they were thinking. You know, for a good solid hour, the movie was solid.
It was a good movie.
I mean, it's still fine. I mean, I like it. It's just, it's so disappointing to see it, you know, fall like that.
It does fall kind of hard.
This is like the end of Shawshank Redemption. you know, it's like the exact same shot. The guy, like the security guard's getting arrested, looking up. All that's missing is when he blows his brains out.
but he does another tactic.
Yeah, he does something else instead.
He shoves something else in his mouth.
Yeah. I love that laugh. Yeah. devouring all the candy canes like that. What was he thinking was going to happen? Yeah, don't you remember in the commentary, the moderator is talking to Gino Schwark. He's like, okay, clearly this is goofy, right? And, you know, Gino didn't really have any clear response to that.
Well, yeah, that's the problem when you question him. He doesn't have answers.
No, I mean, he's obviously a competent director, but he doesn't really seem to want to explain some things.
Well, it's because he doesn't have the answers.
He doesn't, no.
That's why he and the Salkind seem to get along really well. They have good ideas, but they can't explain them. They would just do what might look cool or something like that. And sometimes it works, and sometimes you're like, what the fuck were you thinking? You know? They don't understand why certain things work and why they don't. That's their problem.
Wait a minute. Where's Patch going?
Is he going to the North Pole?
Is that what he's doing? Because he has
all the
candy canes. Isn't he supposed to deliver them?
I don't know. Maybe once he found Joe, maybe he decided he was going to go back to the North. Because clearly that's where he's going.
Yeah, that's what we're missing. Because after he talked with Joe, he saw the elf portrait. He's like, oh, I can go back. He still likes me. We forgot about that.
Yeah, so why is he flying back? He could just teleport.
Yeah, what the hell? He did teleport there. He doesn't need to fly back.
Unless he wants, he did build this car. He's like, fuck you, I'm taking the car. Clearly, it's only going to take him 20 minutes.
Yeah, you're right. I never thought about that. He could have just gone back. Yeah. Oh, that is a giant hole, sir, that I had never thought about.
Come on, boys. Let's patch in there. If you love him like he loves you, give it all you got.
Yeah, see,
what?
This is a conflict without a villain at this point, but we don't care.
BZ's gone.
Well, BZ's gone, and come on. Do we really think they're going to blow up? No. You know. So, I don't know. And at this point, we're so disconnected. It's not Santa Claus anymore.
No. Something has to blow up, though.
Yeah.
Something. There has to be an explosion of some kind.
Yeah, there shouldn't be explosions in Santa Claus.
Mm-hmm. That's cool, though, when he stands up in the sleigh.
Yeah.
Like, come on! Give me all you got!
Turbo boost!
Yeah, hit the turbo boost button. Yeah, it's like, he stands up, the reindeer like, oh, okay, you really want us to go fast. Okay.
I do like this shot, though, coming up right here. That. Where he sees the sleigh come out from underneath, and they're like, holy shit, yeah!
Yeah, that is a good reveal.
It is a nice reveal from their perspective.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Like, now that's a sleigh!
Yeah.
Oh, I forgot about gravity!
And in actuality, he did not really need to do this, did he? He didn't need to flip.
No, it was ridiculous if he had stayed under them.
Yeah, why not just stay under him the whole time?
Almost guarantees you're going to miss them. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Santa Claus, they make no reference to if he can hover or not. If he could hover underneath the thing, I guess not.
I guess, but he could have slowed
down. Does the sleigh have a stall speed? I mean, they don't necessarily, they don't say. So... I guess it does. Maybe that's why.
No, they just wanted a dynamic shot, you know, and yeah, problems.
That's funny though. The Salkinds get to have two movies that, you know, have Arctic locations. You know, Fortress of Solitude and Santa's House.
They should have had the fortress out in the background somewhere. Superman flying in.
What about Corny?
See, I should have adopted him a long time. And they keep Corny.
Yeah, you can't do that. That's kidnapping.
Yeah, her mother is going to wonder. I mean, her mother, as dim-witted as she is going to be like, where's
still,
my daughter?
At least Joe doesn't apparently have a family.
Yeah.
School?
I mean, it's
if it
cute.
Were if it were made today, they would make the tag of the movie, like, you know, The Dark Knight Rises, where it would end with Joe, you know, stepping into a room where he's going to wear a junior Santa Claus outfit.
Right.
He's like Santa in training. And that's the future Mrs. Claus too, you know.
Yeah, see, this is nice. We get a cap back in the
It's
house,
a nice cap.
But
yes.
It's by this point
we're too disconnected. We're
it's gone too long without this, and you're like, oh, well, this is too little too late, you know?
Exactly. And then this.
Oh, the him in space.
Yeah. Come yeah. On.
That is too much. That clearly crosses. He's in space. This is Superman 4.
I know. Didn't they learn? Although they didn't do Superman 4, but.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Well.
Well. Pierre Spangle Spangler. Who the hell did the score?
We're going to find out here.
David, that's where I thought David Newman.
That's weird. It says David and Leslie Newman. And it only says David Newman. Oh, there it is. Screenplay by David. Okay.
What do you think of the curtain call?
I like curtain calls. In general.
You know, it's so funny, but whenever we've done a commentary where there is a curtain call, I point out the fact that I generally don't like curtain calls, but in every movie that
I've seen them in,
we've done that have them, I'm like, I love this curtain call.
Yeah, this is a good curtain call. Dune was a good curtain call. And yeah. Time Bandits has a good curtain call.
Yeah. Oh, Henry Mancini, it just said, did the score.
Yeah, I got you. Okay, I see it. I recognize the name vaguely.
He's more of a classic film composer.
Okay.
I think his you know, days are done. I don't think he does them anymore.
Okay. What do you think of the ending song?
Refresh my memory. What is it again?
Oh, do I have to sing it now?
Just give me a piece.
It's Christmas.
Oh, yes.
What a wonderful world. All over the world.
It's got a great melody, but yeah. I could have done without the lyrics.
It's a little cheesy, yeah.
Doom, doom. You know.
Mm-hmm.
There it is. Sheena Easton did it.
Yeah.
Who's so...
I know that name.
Sheena Easton?
Yeah.
She was an 80s.
80s singer, yeah. I can't place what
she did one of the Bond
songs. Yeah, songs. I knew that from...
I want to say she did the one that you like, For Her Eyes Only. I think she did For Your Eyes Only.
Yeah. Only for you.
Exactly.
Okay, I'm sorry. Don't get me started.
Only for you.
I'll say that. That's a good Bond movie. But anyway, so
you know, like you said, it was pretty much at the hour mark where the movie starts to fall apart, and the movie is at an hour and basically 45 minutes when it goes to credits. So, you know, all they really needed to do was
look at that. David Hultzlin is third billed.
Who's does Burgess Meredith have? Oh, and Dudley Moore.
Dudley Moore, and then it was John Lithgow, and then it was David Huddleston.
Well,
wow.
Gotta be fair, I guess. Christopher Reeve did not have first credit.
That's true.
He did by the second one, I think. But
yeah, he did. He did.
Yeah, at some point he goes into the studio after the first one. He goes, "Fuck you, I'm number one."
Like, I'm the guy in the title.
I understand the first time, but not again. Not again. You can give Gene second credit.
So,
I think, you know, it's kind of common knowledge with this movie that if the second half did not take place in the modern times, it would be a better movie. They could still have essentially the same story. Just don't put it in the 80s. Put it earlier. Give it a period feel. And address, as we kept pointing out, address the themes that they brought up. And continue them. And give them resolution, which they don't. So, yeah, it's a shame. Because as you know, our interest waned during the commentary. It's pretty much from that hour mark forward is when it started to fall apart.
Yeah, it's sad that had to happen during our commentary, but I had a feeling it would. Mm. Just as it has happened during some of our other commentaries. I mean,
When the movie starts to break down.
When the movie starts to break down. It happened in Logan's Run recently. But there still is a lot.
They don't give you much to talk about, unfortunately.
No, but that's not to say that we still don't enjoy the movie. Same goes for Logan's Run. We love it for its faults, you know. This movie is the same way. And Justin, you've pretty much reiterated what we've already discussed, so there's no reason to really repeat that. But I still stand by the movie, of course. I still love it. Oh, it'll always have a place for me. Any time of year, I'll put this movie on. It doesn't matter.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I always enjoy it.
Mm-hmm. But I think that's all we can say for Santa Claus the movie. All right. Well, Merry Christmas. Happy New Year, everyone. Thank you for listening. I'm Josh, Soulless Minions of Orthodoxy. Good night.
Sweet Prince.
I don't know what that
Jesus.
Was.
Jesus, you had a lot in there, buddy.
Really?
Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, Feliz Navidad.
Happy Hanukkah.
Happy Hanukkah. Happy Kwanzaa.
Happy Hanukkah. Kiss my ass. Kiss your ass.
And on that note.
All right, good night. Good night.